Hey everyone, I am Damian Holbrook from TV Guide Magazine and TV Insider, and I am so excited to be here for NBC's La Brea, Survival and the Unexpected Journey panel with the cast and creators of NBC's La Brea. So welcome Comic-Con, and welcome all of you guys. Let's introduce our panel here. First we have Natalie Zea, who plays Eve, Eoin Macken, who plays Gavin, Jon Seda, who plays Sam, Chike Okonkwo, who plays Ty, Nicholas Gonzalez, who plays Levi, and executive producers and showrunners David Applebaum, Stephen Lillian, and Brian Winbrand. Guys, everyone, Natalie, congratulations. One of the biggest new shows of the season.
Banana.
You need to stay tuned to the end of this panel because you're going to get a special sneak peek at the La Brea season finale. And if you've been watching up until the 9th episode, you are not going to want to miss this because let me just tell you, it's insane. But before we get started, let's just look at where we left off this week.
Isaiah is Gavin.
And he needs your help.
There's a portal on top of a mountain in Topanga, and it leads to 1988. If Isaiah doesn't make it, your children will die.
There's something very important I need you to do.
I need you to take me to Topanga, and we have to leave now.
I saw this rock in that world, and someone called me by a different name.
What was it?
Lily.
There's sinkhole locations. Look at this.
And according to this map, the one in Seattle is going to open tomorrow.
The ravine ends 4 miles east of here. Bring Isaiah there, or I'll kill them both.
Eve, wait, you shouldn't go alone.
I don't have a choice. I have to save my son.
Okay, so, big stuff, twist to the showrunners and executive producers. I talked to Brian earlier. You have packed so much story into 10 episodes, like literally 3 seasons of twists and developments. Like, how big was the Bible for this show?
One of the great things about the show is that we had a really long gestation period. We started filming the pilot right before the pandemic, and then we shut down. And we had basically over a year of thinking and planning. We had a mini room of writers where we started developing the stories for the first part of the season and thinking about the arc of the first season. That gestation period really allowed us to come up with all these great twists and turns in a way that a lot of, you know, network shows never really have the ability to do because you're usually on such a tight time schedule for the writing.
And you have a very big cast that you had to serve. And literally, like, this is the thing that, like, you need kind of like a scorecard to figure out where everyone is and how difficult was it getting this very ambitious project greenlit? Because genre stuff doesn't have the easiest time, especially on network TV.
You know, like any project, it was a challenge. But I think one of the things that really made NBC want to greenlight the show is that we were always thinking about the long game. When I went and pitched the show originally, I told them about big ideas for the first season, big ideas for subsequent seasons. And then when Brian and Steven came on board as co-showrunners with me, we continued to develop that and step that out. So we've always been thinking about the long game because that's so important with shows in this genre, not wanting to, you know, disappoint the audience without having a good plan. And I think where the end of the first season goes, you really see a lot of these storylines pay off in cool and surprising ways.
Brian and Steven, when you came on board, how far had this story evolved? Like, where were you in that development?
Well, you know, David had written 2 scripts, the pilot and the second episode. And so we had read the second episode. We kind of got together. The 3 of us had some ideas of things we could take from the second episode, but extend, you know, and one of the things was the portal. You know, we had talked about the portal closing and we wanted to extend that to the 6th episode to give the first 6 episodes this shape. And I think that was part of, you know, when we had the big meeting with NBC to get the green light to series, we talked about here's the shape of these first 6 episodes and we're going to turn over cards. We're going to give the audience reveals because I think it's incumbent upon storytellers now to really push things forward in a way that feels propulsive, but like Dave said, with organized and with a plan. And, you know, especially with binge watching from Netflix, I mean, for the networks, you have to bring it. So that was something we really wanted to do. And I think we were able to accomplish that.
Steven?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing was knowing exactly where we wanted to go with our characters and the story at the end of season 1 and how it was going to propel us into season 2. And that sort of freed us up to turn over larger cards. We weren't afraid to reveal things knowing what we had in store. And I think that, you know, in a show like this, when you have so many characters, it takes a few episodes for audiences to know who everyone is and remember their names, simple things like that. And I think just trying to, once the survivors sort of settled in, you know, spend time with them, who they are, who the loved ones they're missing, what are the dynamics. And I think more than anything, that's what the fans have hooked on early is the characters and rooting for them and that family to get back together.
And that's the thing, the way you've planted these other relationships have been, it's been really well paced out. Like the fact that it took us so long to realize that, like Sam, you know, he and Riley, they have a son. You know, he has a son back up that we just met. And you're like, oh God, that's right. These people all got divided. And then you've got the central family, which I'm loving. I love that Eve and Josh are together and then Gavin and Izzy are together because I kind of hope every season we get a different permutation of the family together. Like if they swap out, like at some point it's like Josh and Izzy and then their parents and do we see them getting back together? Like, so these are my theories, but very masterful of giving us an Eve who I like the fact that it's the first woman, but also that she's very adept at surviving in this environment. Not something we're used to seeing. And also, Natalie, were you looking to get into something like this? Because this is not something we're used to seeing you in.
No, I thought I was going to do comedy forever. I thought I was just going to like become Phyllis Diller and just, you know, get really old and do my bits. And then this came along and my husband was actually the one who was like, listen, this is a really great opportunity for you because not for nothing, but you know, there's a shelf life for one to be running and jumping and climbing. And you've never done anything like this before. So he said, you know, I would hate for you to have this opportunity and you know, think down the line, I wonder what would have happened if I was that action star, but I'm not. And so he's the one who convinced me because I was like, no, I do the funny stuff now. So this was very unexpected for me.
Also, you know, she's very strong, but she's messy. She can navigate 10,000 BC, but how is she navigating the fact that she has a husband she was separated from who has been proven to be right, like he wasn't crazy. But then you have Levi, who was basically the first white knight to show up in her rescue.
Yeah, I think she's doing a lot of compartmentalizing. I think at this point, survival has to be sort of number one on the list of things to do. And like, you know, being horny has to be a little further down there. So I think that you know, weirdly, having to survive is a good distraction for her to sort of be in denial about her personal life being in such shambles.
Because she's not giving Levi an inch. Like,
no, she's busy. She's busy trying to save the world.
And Eoin, are you kind of bummed that you don't get to play on the 10,000 BC set?
No, because it's been cold in Australia. So, you know, honestly, I really liked the situation that the character's in because I thought it was a really interesting dynamic putting Gavin and Izzy together. And I thought that father relationship that we had to kind of go through at the same time as dealing with the possible loss of our family was a really fun and challenging arc to play with. So it didn't really matter to me where they put me. I just really enjoyed working with Zaira and I just really enjoyed kind of going down that weird redemptive arc and also not knowing what the hell was going on. So
at all.
Yeah, I could have been in a box, a room or a forest and I still wouldn't have known what was happening anyway. So
how early in the production were you aware of the twist?
I still don't know what the twist is. So if anyone wants to shed some
great,
light.
You were great.
No, genuinely, I mean, that was part of the fun of actually doing this show. These guys were great. They just give you the information as you went along, and it really helped when you're playing these characters because you didn't really know what was going to happen.
What is it? Nothing. It's just a headache.
Oh! And that was incredibly enjoyable and a bit scary because usually you kind of have a bit more of an idea of where things are going to go, possibly. But that sense of being kind of confused and isolated from everybody and kind of disconcerted, it was kind of really worked for what was happening. So I dug that.
And Nicholas, you're the only one who has actually worked really in both of the worlds.
Right. Yeah, kind of brought those together a little bit.
Yeah. How different is the down below versus back in LA?
It's colder. It's definitely colder. You're out there in the conditions. It's much more, it's beautiful. It's beautiful out there. I mean, the Australian countryside is absolutely gorgeous, but it's two very different kind of work schedules and work environments, you know, because Eoin was always on some set or, you know, in an office somewhere, or I don't know. I mean, didn't you go to a ranch one point? You guys rode horses.
It sounded
like a lot of fun.
You know, there was a couple of days I had to stop doing it, actually, because people stopped replying to me in the group chat. But I would send videos of just what a lovely environment I was filming in, and these, like, you know, nice houses, and it's warm, and we're in a ranch or inside, and they were all outside in a hurricane in the cold. And then people just stopped replying to me. So,
But then Eoin started showing up on set because he missed everybody, because that's one of the best things about the show that I think.
I had to come in for a haircut. I didn't show up on my own volition. I had no choice. What are you talking about?
It's a 3.5 hour round trip for a haircut.
Right. I did have a 3.5 hour round trip for a haircut.
Wow. Wow. Okay. All right. So,
by the way, they're not joking. I mean, what these guys had to endure, I mean, in the elements, I mean, it's incredible. And we are so grateful to them, because there's not a lot of people, a lot of actors who had to deal with what they had to deal with for 10 episodes straight. So it really was an incredible. So Eoin really did get off easy. Let's be honest.
Yeah. I mean, I do remember Jon Seda comparing the conditions to, you know, Leo DiCaprio in The Revenant. Didn't you say that?
Yeah, at least, John, you got to film half the first season in the bus.
Yeah, right?
You were like crippled for 3 episodes.
I can't feel my legs.
Yeah, but I guess that's kind of true. It's pretty cool. We actually had a bus in the studio. We had one that was outside, out in the clearing, that was actually in the elements out there, and then we had when I was in the studio, which is pretty cool. Made it a lot easier.
And this guy, he's like a doctor and an ex-Navy SEAL. Like, these are a lot of things for one character to be carrying around with him. Did you do any research, or were you just like, I'm in the past, so I don't even have to worry about that?
No, I did no research. I just brought out the SEAL and the doctor that is in me. No, of course. No, I have a lot of friends that are Marines, and just kind of have that in my background. So if there's ever something that it can apply to, or just naturally just comes out. And the doctor stuff, I mean, you know, I think Nick knows a lot about the doctor stuff.
You and I had a scene where I think it was with Vanessa Buckley when she was shot.
Right.
And or maybe it was before that, and I had to help you, and I had to act like I knew nothing. And you're whispering to me, what do I do? And I'm like, I don't know, dude. I'm doing my thing.
Is this how I hold the wound? Is this it?
America's never going to believe you, Jon Seda.
Well, John, as we get into the finale, and this portal that the survivors are looking for presents the opportunity for people to go home, but I know that people will also decide to stay back. Is there a possibility that we're going to see, like, Sam and Riley have to kind of say goodbye or make that decision?
Yeah, I mean, everyone's making their decision on whether they want to go or stay, and for whatever rhyme or reason. I think Sam and Riley, they're still holding on to that hope that they're going to get back to their family. And, you know, I think they make a solid decision together.
So, Chike, if Natalie's character is kind of like the muscle of the show, I feel like Ty is the heart of the show. He's got this deeply emotional backstory. This is the guy who wanted to die, and it seems like the fates have told him, no, you don't get to die today. We actually need you to help save the world.
This place doesn't seem real, does it?
How nice is it to get this kind of arc?
Oh, it's a dream for an actor to start at that position, because, you know, the great thing that the guys did with the backstory is that Ty found out that morning that he doesn't have much longer to live. And then his day got even worse by falling into a giant sinkhole. So, you know, he comes to the show with a lot of baggage. It's just a great place to start when you think, okay, he wants to die. He wants to shoot himself right at the beginning of the show. But throughout the arc of the season, he he gets to find purpose again. And I think that was just one of the best things for me as an actor, to be able to dig into that storyline.
Is it dead?
And to meet people along the way who really affect him, like he has this connection with Eve at the beginning, with Dr. Sam, and really finds a purpose again in helping people, because that's what he did best when he was a psychiatrist above ground.
Right, because it's like all of a sudden this guy who wanted to die is pivotal in keeping a whole bunch of people that he does not know alive.
Hmm.
There's a nice chemistry between Ty and Eve where they both kind of, there's a mutual respect, but also I feel like just a general fondness, like these two would be friends up above.
Yeah, I agree. And I think we were really lucky to find that as the season developed. And some of the stuff that I enjoyed the most was connecting with Natalie, connecting with John's character, Sam. It was nice to be able to build those bonds, because you're just thrown in. Like you said, so much happens in those first couple of episodes. So you're just thrown in, and then, you know, hopefully we get to meet Eoin and Zaira at some point down below, or above, we'll see. But,
right.
You know, it'll be nice to be able to work with Eoin as well, because I'm sure he's nice.
Sorry. Oh, and you've only worked with Natalie and Nicholas so far, right? Like, on this panel, these are the only people you've gotten to share screen time with.
Yes, that was you know, that we had, that was in the contract. To,
right. Theirs or yours?
Exactly. Yours. That is true. Yeah, I got to work with Nick for one episode, and then we got on really well. And then they were like, oh, you guys are having a nice time. We'll stop that.
I'm going to separate you.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Two bulls in the pen at once. I don't know. It was.
Yeah.
And I'm still kind of on the fence. Like, do we trust Levi? Like, do I count on this guy? Like, he seems to be noble, but then telling the son the truth. I was like, oh, I don't know if that's a story to tell. What do you think, Nicholas? Where does Levi stand here?
Yeah, what do you think, Nicholas? Where does Levi stand here?
You know, all's fair in 10,000 BC, I think, is the first rule we know. But going from there, I think that was like written on every one of our scripts. Was one thing they ingrained into us about whatever happens in 10,000 BC, no one else can see except for Eoin. And I don't know, that was a tough thing I always kind of grappled with, because one of the main things when David and I sat down and talked about Levi, and we you know, we had a call and talked about what we thought about how do you grapple with that he's this really great, trustworthy guy.
You're the pilot.
Captain Levi Delgado. It's a pleasure to meet you all.
And it seems weird to use the word trustworthy and honorable with something that happened, but I think people realize that life is not black and white, and things are so gray, and this kind of situation, which is so fantastical in so many different ways, even in the way that them being distanced apart that allowed Levi and Eve to even happen, was because of such crazy extenuating circumstances that it's like we're kind of at the odds of, you know, the gods, you know, that are kind of throwing all this in our way. And you get these people together, you can't help, I think, that emotions are going to flow. And that's what happened, you know, and I think there's a lot of guilt. There's definitely a lot of guilt on not only Eve, but Levi for sure.
Chike, the whole brain tumor thing, you know, it has been mentioned. He seems to be doing okay. And I'm starting to wonder, like, is being in the past kind of like, the tumor's not there anymore, or maybe.
Great question.
There's some kind of effect that it's having on the body to stave it off, or.
You know,
can you give us anything?
I'm a fan of all the theories, but I think from Ty's perspective, genuinely, it's the fact that he's had this stuff to do, these people to be a part of, this group to sort of help him. So I don't know, that maybe that's a question for David, Brian, and Stephen as to how the brain tumor sticks around or doesn't. But you know, I think certainly for Ty in that first season, he had a lot to work towards, a lot of things to focus on. Loved working with Lily Santiago and Chloe de los Santos. It was so nice to be able to, for Ty to be able to really use the skills he had in the real world to try and bring people together. So yeah, I don't know. It's again another great thing to play. The fact that he hasn't seemingly got much time left. So we'll see. You know, everything's up for grabs in 10,000 BC.
Because I feel like that's the thing that would make him like, maybe I should stay back behind here and like hang out with these other villagers. Which now brings me to that. Because did you guys, the actors, did you know that you were going to eventually run into a whole other cast of people? That you were going to get, like, some neighbors?
No, that was a surprise for me.
Because, like, all of a sudden I was like, wait, there are other people down there and they're okay with this? which, I also love, by the way, the most harrowing moment so far is when Eve's phone died. Mm. When the power went, it bleeped out. I was like, oh, we are screwed now. For the showrunners, you know, I talked with Brian, and there are big cards being flipped over in the final episode. You're giving a ton of answers. I want to know what the story really is with Silas. What the hell is this? I want to know more about the cult, because you know Veronica and Lily, that was a cult, like straight up cult. And these other villages, like they mentioned them. People came from a boat. Now, Brian said it's probably not the Titanic, which I'll get, but who on set is keeping track of all of these little threads?
That's a great question. You know, we did have a writer producer who was on set for multiple episodes. I was also there for the shooting of the pilot in the second episode. And we have a great producing director, Adam Davidson, who directed multiple episodes, who is keeping track of the story. But you're right. It is, you know, there is a lot going on. There are 13 series regulars, stories in multiple worlds. There's a lot to keep track of. But I think one of the great things about this group of actors is that they're really invested in the story and that they're tracking it and that you have to in order to be able to play these moments right. But you're right. You know, there is a kitchen sink aspect to it. But I think that's one of the appeals of the show is that you never know what's going to happen. You never know what storylines can happen. You never know who's going to appear down there because, you know, we've kind of set up a world where really anything can happen and you can meet anyone.
Like historical character figures, like people who just went missing. Jimmy Hoffa could show up.
He could. Season 5.
I think we're just scratching the surface of the world. You know, we've introduced in season 1 where Lucas and, you know, they find the gold bars and it's like, how did Civil War gold end up in 10,000 BC? And, you know, we're just sort of letting the audience know that there is more to this world. And I think that's what sets up a lot of the interesting things we want to do for season 2. You can always introduce new characters, but I think most importantly, it's investing in our current group of characters and understanding coming out of season 1, what's going to propel us forward. And we have such exciting things for the finale that's going to shake up our core characters and our storytelling that's going to launch us in season 2, which we're super excited about.
And for the actors, there are certain things that actors have to do, suspension of disbelief, but when you're told you have to react to a giant sloth, how do you get your head around that one?
You just pretend.
Right.
It's just playing pretend. It really is. I mean, it like you've seen it done a million times on other shows and movies, so you just do that.
Right.
I think it works.
Like, but when it's a sloth where you're like, they could probably take this thing down, but then you realize it would eviscerate them with his claws. I just love that touch of like you've taken something that we've kind of turned into like something cute and like it's a stuffed animal and turned it into a predator.
Yeah.
It was hungry. It wanted to eat, you know?
Baby roots. I mean, it's
a baby root, yes.
It's not really that bad, Damien. You're blowing that out of proportion. He's still gentle in how he stole the food.
He was gentle, you're right. And also I was worried, like, I don't know if his system is okay with this modern food. So the one thing that I noticed as I was watching these episodes is, there's no villain yet. You have not planted us with anyone so far that we know who we need to kind of fight against, or the person who's pulling the strings, or the organization, or maybe the government that is what they're doing. Is that something we should expect to find out that there is a reason behind all of this?
Well, you know, the thing is, I would just say that the idea of a villain is always a tricky thing because it's interesting for us to look at both sides of the story for a character. You know, why someone is doing something, if you ground them in a reason that is understandable. For instance, with Silas, this is his grandson. So he's working against us, but he has his own emotional reason. So is he a villain or is he someone who is coming from a place that is understandable? And I think we do have characters and we do have a plan. And one of the big reveals at the end of the season will give context to that. But again, I think we look at it through the lens of no one's a real bad guy, so to speak. Everyone just has different agendas.
How far flung will our characters be in the finale? Like, when you end that last episode, how dire will it look?
It's a great question. I mean, I think, you know, without giving away what actually happens, you know, this is a story about a family trying to reconnect emotionally and physically, and they're on that path into the finale, but it won't be easy. They are going to be separated in new and interesting ways. We're going to be putting characters in different worlds moving into season two. There's going to be a lot of unexpected surprises that are going to happen at the end of the finale that are going to put our characters in a lot of different places. But also, you know, we're going to retain a lot of what we saw in season one. There's still going to be characters in the clearing trying to figure out how to survive down here. But one of the goals of the show as we move into future seasons is to expand what the show can be. So that's just something that we're constantly thinking about and trying to think, you know, what else can the show do?
Have any of the actors had costume fittings for, say, 1988 wardrobe?
It is my wardrobe.
The hair.
Right, the hair. Yes, that's why it's growing out. How much did you let the cast know about what season two will look like?
You know, I think we've hinted at it through what happens in episode 10, but, you know, those are still things that we're, you know, we haven't put out wide yet. But, you know, we will as time goes on.
Now's the time.
Okay.
Right? I think
we're here now.
And this is close to the finale. So, I mean, you might as well give the fans a little something.
I'm sure the fans would love to know.
I'll never tell.
any of the actors... Looks like you're doing a lot of stunt work, or at least some unpleasant terrain to work with. I know there's a lot of, you know, green screen and TV magic as well, but has anyone gotten like really into just running amok and doing their own stuff?
Actually, everyone.
I mean, yeah, I think we all do as much as we can that is safe. I don't know that anyone's sort of bowed out of anything that they feel like they can or should do. But safety, you know, safety was a big concern on our set. And if it was going to be in any way dangerous to us, we were taken out of the equation. But yeah, I think everybody was really up for it.
I'm really excited to see the Navy SEAL part of Dr. Sam's character just come out. So that that's something that has to happen eventually.
Right. We get to some water, get him out there.
We have some great stunt people.
Yeah. Last question for you guys, for all of you. When you saw those premiere numbers and when you saw those ratings just blowing up with like extended viewing and people finding on streaming and all that stuff, for the showrunners, did that really kind of give you that juice to be like, all right, we can go full forward on this? And for the actors, were you like, yes, this landed right?
Yeah, I mean, it's such a validation of everyone's hard work, you know. I think, you know, you're so inside the bubble of this thing for so long, and you hope people are going to like it and you feel like they will, but then, you know, just to see 15 million people watching, it's so exciting. I think we're all, you know, thrilled by it.
I think it's great. It's really it's incredible to be a part of something that people care about. But I mean, first and foremost, it's incredible to be a part of a show where, like, you know, you really enjoy working with the people, you know, you get to work with. But just being a part of a show like this is so much fun and exciting. So it is very cool when people respond to it in the way that you hope they will.
Yeah, I think like you said, it makes it worth it. You know what I mean? It's like all the hard work, not just with us, but the crew, you know, and everybody out there just giving everything they have to try to make the best product that they can. And then to see those numbers, it's like, it just really, really makes it seem like it was worth it.
Yeah, so many hands touched this along the way. So, I mean, you know, they're doing their thing back here in LA, sending it to us, you know, and we're trying to hold up our side. And then everyone's wondering how it's going to then be when it's edited. And, you know, there's so many different people that get their hand in on this and have their artistry in a different way, in a lot of ways that we're all surprised with. I'm sure there were a lot of unexpected surprises for the producers who even knew certain effects that they wanted. But then to see it all kind of put together in the way that they've been editing is something very different than I was even imagining when we were on set. So to see it come together, I think we're all just kind of like, wow, it's really, you know, it's working.
Yeah.
And that's the great thing as well about having such a big idea, about having this really big world idea that you're going to build this world out, having people come along and really invest in every single part of that world is so gratifying from our perspective. And just, yeah, there's just so much more that can be done with each character, with each strand, with all these mysteries. I think one of the great things about the show is there are always answers as well. There are so many questions, but there are so many answers. So I can't wait for people to tune in on Tuesday to watch the finale, because like you are also enjoying the ride along the way. It's not just mystery for mystery's sake.
All right. Well, listen, you guys, thank you so much. Thank you, Comic-Con. This is fantastic. I hope you guys had a good time. Now for an exclusive sneak peek at the La Brea season finale. Let's roll that.
Got it. Don't look down, okay? You got it.
Josh, you got him?
Yeah. We're good.
Hey, you're up, Eve.
Okay.
Hey, you got it. Just one at a time. Looking good.
Easy.
Just a few more rungs. You got it, Eve.
Come on, Mom. You can do this.
Take my hand. Take my hand.
All right, so now you guys know, do not miss the La Brea season finale, November 30th at 9 p.m. on NBC. Everybody, thank you so much. Congratulations on an awesome first season, and we will see you next season in whatever time zone we land in with our portal. So thank you.
Thank you. Cheers.
Thank you.
Run!